Hello, everyone. Welcome to this edition of CBN News Weekend. I'm George Thomas. Well, the war in Syria has scattered millions of people. Some 2,000 of them have managed to come here to the United States. They've been accepted here after going through the government's vetting process. One Christian group called Church World Services works with these refugees to make sure they adjust to their new life. Abigail Robertson shows us how that led to a successful transition for one Syrian family here in their new country.
They've escaped war zones, survived refugee camps, and just arrived in the United States to start a new life. Now, Middle East refugees face a new list of challenges. Where will they live? How will they pay the bills? Where do they learn English? And how do they enroll their children in school? Daunting questions that some Christian groups are helping the refugees answer.
This is work that is very significant, and it's a need in our world right now, and it's something we can actively do.
It is amazing what can be done when people come together, and what better way to make a refugee family feel at home in America than by welcoming them with a furnished apartment with food already in their fridge. That is exactly what churches throughout the nation are accomplishing by coming together, serving people, and showing them the love of Christ. Church World Services works with churches around the country to help refugees from the moment they arrive at the airport.
And when we know that they're going to come, we'll get an email, we'll get an arrival notice, and that's when we're going to start hitting the ground running.
First up, finding a house for the family to rent. Then stocking it with necessities like furniture, food, and toiletries. Next, CWS pairs each new family with a church partner. Fortunately, they currently have a list of churches waiting to sponsor families from all countries and religious backgrounds.
A welcome team is usually a church group, but sometimes small groups, very intentional groups of people who come together and say, we're going to work with a family. It adds this holistic element of community.
CWS's end goal is simple: teach each incoming family how to be self-sufficient in America. That process happens through three programs: resettlement, employment counseling, and immigration legal services. They work closely for up to 5 years with each family as they acclimate to their new society.
It's just very, very, very encouraging to watch families reach milestones.
Farhan, a Syrian, arrived with his family 5 months ago. Their journey here began in 2011 when the UN approached them about resettlement in the US. Then came 4 years of vetting overseas until they received clearance to come to America, where they found an unexpected and loving welcome.
We had a misconception about the people here, but that all changed.
Thanks to CWS, Farhan becomes more comfortable every day. His English is improving, he's working, and his daughter made it to the top of her high school class. Before being granted refugee status, many families wait an average of 3 years as they get health and security clearances. For many of them, that time is spent inside refugee camps or hiding in the shadows of other Middle Eastern countries already overwhelmed by the refugee exodus. While Farhan's family awaited resettlement, one of his sons turned 18 and, as a legal adult, was separated from his family's case.
He's in Jordan alone. No one is there to support him. He's not allowed to work in Jordan. His situation is very dire.
CWS tries to bring families back together, but it's not an easy legal process.
In our office, we're able to apply for family reunification, reuniting family members who have faced that sort of separation. They have to go through the same exact background check process as with refugees who are arriving without family members already here. So on average, that still takes 3 years.
Christine told us one lonely mom's story.
We had a recently arrived woman who came to Lancaster, and we did not know that she was separated from her husband and children. This mother was just recently reunited with her 16-year-old daughter, and she had not seen her 16-year-old daughter in person for 6 years. Being able to offer a space where families can be reunited after being separated for so long is extraordinary. I have no words for it.
Christine sees the perseverance of these refugees as a positive and asks Christians to pray for them through their entire journey.
These families are very resilient, survivors in a lot of ways, and not in any way helpless.
Farhan wants Americans to know that with a little help in the beginning, Syrian refugees can adjust just fine.
My call to the American people is like, we need help in the beginning, and then we will stand on our feet and do our part and work, and we want to work so we can be better and better.
Farhan's family's journey has been far from easy, and they still face many challenges ahead. But the support they've received from Church World Services has proved essential to helping them adjust to their new life in America and become productive members of their new community. Reporting from Lancaster, Abigail Robertson, CBN News.
Wow, what a terrific program. And joining us from D.C. Is Abigail. Abigail, I'm curious, how are families selected for this process?
So I first just want to say how they're selected for resettlement in the U.S. in general. So basically, they're overseas, they're living in refugee camps, they apply with the United Nations, are vetted by the United Nations. The U.N. then decides which country they will be resettling in. The families have no say where they'll be going. And quite frankly, a lot of them would prefer to be resettled in Europe, where they're closer to the Middle East, closer to where they're from, and the culture is way more similar to what they grew up in. But the ones that are resettled in the United States then have to get vetted by the U.S. background checks. So a lot of times these families wait 3 to 7 years before they ever arrive on U.S. soil. And they have no idea that when they get here, the work that CWS and other organizations have already done for them. Mm-hmm. So CWS gets a notification anywhere from a week to a month before the family comes. They hit the ground running. They find the apartment, stock the apartment, stock the house, find a church to kind of sponsor them.
Yeah.
And then they arrive in the airport and are just overwhelmed with all the love and the blessings that CWS has provided for them.
Yeah. And talk to that issue of being overwhelmed. What do you think is the biggest challenge for these refugees trying to adjust to their new life in America?
I think one of the biggest challenges is a lot of them don't speak English. And they, you know, the United Nations has told them where they'll be resettling, and they don't even speak the native tongue. So they come here and they know they need to find a job. Some of them could be doctors, lawyers, teachers. But when they arrive in the U.S., none of their credentials matter. And if they want to, you know, resume those careers, they have to start all over again. So a lot of them take lower paying jobs. They then have to find a way to put their children in school, again, in schools that aren't taught in their native language. Some of these are high schoolers, which it would be extremely challenging to learn chemistry or anything in a language that wasn't even what you're familiar with. And so just kind of adjusting to the culture and finding places where they can even buy their native food and anything that's remotely familiar to them.
Yeah. What are some of the, I guess, smaller challenges we might not think of? You've mentioned some of the big challenges. What are some of the smaller challenges?
Well, I think something that none of us think of is when they arrive in these houses, they've never seen a lot of these appliances before. Yeah. They don't even know how to flip. Some of them don't know how to flip on a light switch.
Wow.
So Christine told me one story about, you know, how when they first started this, they used to get the family from the airport, bring them to their new house, and then they kind of wanted to leave the families be for 24 hours, let them adjust before overwhelming them with information. But she told me a story about how they came back 24 hours later, and the family had taken the coffee table, broken it up into firewood, and built a fire inside the new apartment because they didn't know how to turn on the lights. So they were in the dark and it was freezing. They didn't know how to turn the heat on. So then that's when they realized that when they get them from the airport and take them to the house, they immediately have to walk them through, show them the stove, show them the microwave, just things that they've never seen before that could be really daunting.
Yeah.
And they're also, you know, they're already kind of in a vulnerable spot. They don't
Sure.
want to do anything to mess up their situation.
Sure.
And they're just nervous to kind of touch anything or mess with anything that they don't know
Wow.
what will happen.
Wow, wow, what an amazing process. And all of them have, so many of them have experienced such tragedy and trauma and now being pulled out of their own communities and resettled in a brand new place. Wow, but what a terrific mm-hmm. ministry. And thank you for bringing attention and honoring this this ministry with this good story. Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia says God has been good to the U.S. because Americans honor him and religious neutrality is not grounded in the Constitution. He made those remarks during a recent speech at Archbishop Rummel High School, where the justice told the audience, quote, "To tell you the truth, there is no place for that in our constitutional tradition." Where did that come from? Scalia is the longest-serving justice on the High Court. He was appointed by President Ronald Reagan back in 1986. Franklin Graham is calling for Americans to pray for our nation and its leaders. This week in Iowa, he kicked off a 50-state prayer campaign called the Decision America Tour 2016. Graham says his hope is in God rather than in political parties, but Iowans need to vote for Christians who are willing to stand and believe and follow biblical principles. He warned that Americans could lose their liberties if Christians don't make their voices heard this election year. Join us tomorrow on The Sunday Show to find out what message Franklin's sister and Graham Lotz has for the United States in 2016. That's on tomorrow's CBN News Sunday. President Obama wants to bring more Syrian refugees into the country, but that move has met with serious opposition because of the concerns that America could be importing terrorism. Dale Hurd has this look at the debate over Islam and immigration.
As Europe's winter closes in on Syrian refugees, many find themselves out in the cold.
The weather is cold. Please help.
As America prepares to accept some of them, many are asking, which of them are true refugees? What is America's role, if any, in helping them? And how many of them are ISIS?
So I take ISIS at its word when it says we want to exploit the refugee program to infiltrate the West.
President Obama says Syrian refugees are less dangerous than tourists, and he wants to bring in at least 10,000 in 2016. But warning signs abound. The Germans say almost one out of three migrants are lying about being Syrian. The Czech president has warned that Europe is facing an organized invasion and not the spontaneous movement of refugees. One young refugee told this Swiss newspaper he met many radical Muslims on his way to Europe. And FBI Director James Comey has warned Congress that Syrian refugees cannot be properly vetted.
It's not just those who come in here who specifically intend to be part of plots to kill Americans. It's also those who may be most easily recruitable in the years to come.
Clifford May, president of the Foundation for Defense of Democracies, says it would only take a few terrorists to get through.
There were only a handful of people involved in the 9/11 attacks.
Just a handful. Is that okay? Are we willing to have a 9/11 attack every 1 year, every 3 years, every 5 years?
Presidential candidate Donald Trump has called for a temporary ban on all Muslim immigration. But when you actually crunch the numbers, those who have gone through the actual refugee vetting process have so far committed no acts of terrorism on American soil.
There have been no refugees admitted since 9/11 who have committed a terrorist attack in the United States.
Immigration policy analyst Alex Nalrasta says Syrian refugees in America would not come through Europe, but from camps in the Middle East. And very few would-be terrorists could make it through the refugee process.
The first level of checks through the refugee system is done by the UN, where they reject 99% of applicants. There are an additional 21 different steps undertaken by the U.S. government that a refugee must go through in order to come to the United States. For a Syrian, that takes about 3 years to go through to come here. So it's a very safe system. It is the hardest way to come to the United States.
There are easier ways for a terrorist to enter the U.S., like green card fraud or a student visa, or simply walking across the border. But what this debate seems to really be about is the religion of the refugees, Islam, and if Islam makes them a potential danger. President Obama, who continues to have trouble saying the words Muslim terrorism, seems to view Islam as the same as other religions, but many former Muslims disagree.
Is it? Is it the same as other religions?
No, it's not. Islam is different than other religions because Islam does not accept any law besides Allah's law.
We asked Brother Rashid, a former Muslim who now hosts a popular Arabic TV program called Daring Questions, if some Muslim migrants are coming to the West not as guests, but as conquerors.
Of course. I have family members in Europe and they think the same thing. I visited them and they think that they hate Europe, they hate the West, they hate their way of life, so they are there to change them.
Brother Rashid says he does not believe, as some do, that every Muslim is a potential terrorist, because he says many Muslims are not serious about their faith. But he warns that all a Muslim needs to do, like the San Bernardino bomber, is suddenly decide to follow the Quran completely. He says that is precisely what ISIS has tried to do.
These guys are devout Muslims. They are not just a bunch of terrorists who did not understand Islam. All these guys understood Islam, studied it. Al-Baghdadi, the head of ISIS, is a PhD holder in Islamic studies, so he must understand Islam to get a PhD.
There are more concerns about Muslim refugees. Polls show most Muslim countries are overwhelmingly anti-Semitic. One survey found that almost 80% of Syrians support the Palestinian terror group Hamas. Polls show most Americans overwhelmingly oppose accepting Syrian refugees, and over 30 states have refused to accept them. America is not only a land of immigrants, it is the most charitable nation on earth. But when it comes to allowing in some Muslim refugees, Americans may be forced to choose between charity and safety.
Well, the NFL playoffs are kicking off this weekend, but one of the teams may be a step closer to winning a big battle off the field. The Washington Redskins have been appealing a court order canceling the team's trademark of their nickname. Back in July, a judge ruled the name was disparaging to Native Americans. More recently, a federal appeals court ruled in a different case the government cannot refuse to register trademarks that may be considered offensive. The Washington team sees this as a possible precedent, allowing them to continue their trademark. But others are pushing the team to change the name, citing the historical meaning of the word redskin.
It's actually used as a way to count bounties and a way to pay people for each of these skins that they received. They would get a bounty for them. And that's where it comes from. It comes from the genocide of Native Americans in the United States.
And while the team battles battles in the courts, the players battle on the field this Sunday against the Green Bay Packers. It's the first hurdle in their quest to reach Super Bowl 50. The team's running back, Alfred Morris, talks about his own journey on the road less traveled on today's Faith on the Field.
The Washington Redskins continue their unexpected winning season, thanks to the footwork of young running back Alfred Morris.
Redskins is my favorite team, so I kind of chuckled at him. I'm like, man, God, you got a sense of humor. I would have never thought that Redskins would be the team that called me, you know, on draft day.
Some called him too slow. Others said he was too small. But
Redskins organization had to see something in me that others didn't. You know, coming out, my prayer was like, God, I don't know what's going to happen with this whole draft situation. But like, just place me exactly where I need to be so I can be used. And he did just that.
Morris proved the skeptics wrong after helping the Redskins win their division in his rookie season and again this year.
It was just goosebumps, like, man, you know, this is really, it's the NFL and I get to play.
And Morris works to remain humble. Despite his big NFL paycheck, he still drives his 1991 Mazda to and from games.
It just keeps me grounded, keeps me home. It reminds me where I came from. You know, like a lot of people get to this level and they forget where they came from. I took a road less traveled.
He grew up in poverty. His family had to work hard for what they had. And no matter the struggles the family faced, they always leaned on God.
I was raised in the church. I mean, if we didn't do anything, we went to church on Sundays, no matter what we did throughout the week. And something that small actually stuck with me in college.
He was awarded a scholarship to play at Florida Atlantic University. But playing football and going to school full time was not easy.
I just hit rock bottom. A lot of stuff was going on. It was a snowball. And God brought me to my lowest point so he can build me back up. I broke down and I just cried. I was like, I can't do it my way. I surrender. I give it all to you. And from that point on, you know, I've been chasing after him ever since. I've just been focused on him ever since. You know, I gave God my heart that day.
Though he grew up in church, he still never fully committed his life to Christ, until that point.
All that time, I was half foot in, half foot out. Once I did get all in, I'm like, man, I've been missing all this the whole time. God completed me. He was that missing piece of the puzzle.
His commitment to Christ stays with him every moment of his NFL career.
I give all the glory to God. I pray before games. I pray between plays. I pray on the sideline for the defense. I pray when people get hurt. I'm always praying on the sideline. Me and God is always in contact. You know, I'm playing a game. Because I said, I do it for him.
And he loves every minute of it.
It's just so fun playing. To be honest, the reason I play, God blessed me with a gift, and I go out there and I use it to glorify him.
He gives all the credit for his success with the Redskins to the Savior, who picked him up from his lowest point.
Without him, I wouldn't be sitting in front of you today. I wouldn't be on this field playing the Redskins. Without God, without Christ in my life, you know, we all have been saved by grace. So, and I just thank Christ for his sacrifice, you know. Like, he didn't have to do it, but he did it willingly. You know, he wanted to do it for us. And that just speaks volumes, you know. And I try to, you know, pattern my life after Christ. It seems cliche. What would Jesus do? You know, if Christ can do it, I can do it. If Christ can love all, I can love all. There's no other love like God's love. God's love is truly unconditional. And, like, get off that fence. Once you fall in his arms, I promise you, you won't regret it. It'll change your life forever.
Faith and football have come together for a Hollywood film called Greater. The movie is based on the incredible real-life story of Brandon Bosworth, who is considered the greatest walk-on in the history of college football. Brandon overcame many challenges to land a spot with the Arkansas Razorbacks. But when tragedy struck, it was his brother's faith that was tested. Greater hits theaters January 29th. For more on the film, you can log on to cbnnews.com. Well, folks, that is it for this hour of CBN News Weekend. We hope you'll join us next time. Have a wonderful weekend. Thank you so much for joining us. And check us out on CBN News as well as on Facebook and on Twitter. Good night, everyone.